Hi, Mr. Greer.
Thank you, Judge. Did they arrest you, Robert?
Yes.
Stay with call, Clint Bearden, please. Raise your right hand, if you swear the testimony you got given in the United States, this meeting is held to prove the whole truth and nothing but the truth of the God.
Yes, sir.
Let's see, please. You introduce yourself, Judge.
Clint Bearden.
And how are you employed, Mr. Bearden?
I'm an attorney in Blue Ridge, Georgia.
And is that all you do to earn money, Mr. Bearden?
No, I also serve as a part-time associate magistrate judge in Dawson County.
All right. And how long have you been an associate magistrate judge now in Dawson County?
January of 2016.
Okay, now, where do you live? What county do you call home?
I live in Dawson County.
All right. How long have you lived in Dawson County, Mr. Bearden?
33 years.
33 years. Long time. Do you know the folks that own Burt's farm?
I do.
How do you know those folks?
They are lifelong friends and neighbors of my parents. I'm a 8th-generation resident of Dawson County, so the Burts and my parents went to high school together. They're former employers of mine. I worked at Burt's Pumpkin Farm all through high school and a couple of summers of college.
All right, so I want to direct your attention to August 23rd, 2014. Remember that day?
I do.
That's what we're going to talk about. Did you encounter the defendant in this case, Ms. Tisdale?
Yes, she was there at the event. I was there with Ms. Tisdale being at the event that day.
All right, now, you say in the event, where was that event at?
It was at Burt's Farm.
All right, now, prior to that day, did you know Ms. Tisdale or even know of Ms. Tisdale?
I did not know who Ms. Tisdale was. After the fact, when I learned that Ms. Tisdale, her name was Nydia Tisdale, and that she was the individual that had been kicked out of a meeting in the city of Cumming. I was familiar with the city of Cumming incident, but I wasn't familiar with her name or her person, like her appearance.
Okay. What were you doing there at Burt's Farm?
On that day, that year, I had previously assisted Governor Deal's campaign. When Nathan Deal, I interned for him in Congress, whenever I had close ties to a lot of people on his staff. So whenever Nathan had ran for governor, I assisted with his campaign, helped just do things in Dawson County and around North Georgia. That particular time, he was running for re-election, of course, and his office had contacted me, his campaign office had contacted me a couple of weeks before that August 23rd date to say, you know, essentially, we've got a lot of events this day.
Yes, I'm about to hear say here.
And I'll get to the point.
Try to explain, and Mr. Harvey's husband said, his belief and what he believed and how he acted. It's not for the truth of the matter, sir. I don't know what the governor's office said.
Organizing a meet and greet type of stop. That was the purpose of putting that together that day was the governor would be in town, he'd be passing through Dawson County, he's running for re-election, it's an opportunity to meet some voters.
Okay, so, and did you organize that rally?
I did, to the extent that I organized, well, to an extent, let me say. Found a location for the governor to come because that's who I had been in contact with. And I spoke to Mr. Burt after looking at some other facility options and realizing that weather might be an issue. I spoke to Mr. Burt because Mr. Burt had previously had a fundraiser for the governor at his farm and it was a good location to do so. That actual event that day kind of morphed into a lot more than just the governor. The 2 weeks before when I was contacted, it was just going to be Governor Deal. Found out a week before that Senate candidate Perdue may attend with the governor if he could, you know, adjust his schedule. The day of the event, when I actually show up, I see the entire Republican Party ticket there. So wasn't expecting everybody across the board to be there, but at that point in time, you know, to say what I organized, I arranged for the governor to be there. It kind of morphed into what it became as like a Republican Party rally at that point in time.
Right. In doing that, were you the go between the Republican Party and Mr. Burt?
That particular day, not really. I mean, to some extent, they contacted me, but beforehand, there wasn't really any communication that I'm aware of. I mean, they didn't contact me to ask Mr. Burt, you know, can Secretary of State speak? Can the, you know, Agriculture Commissioner speak? Any of those people? The governor's folks stayed in communication with me about the event that day. When I showed up, they had what's called a run of show. They had a list of the speakers, what order they were going to go in. You know, that day when there were requests to be made, they did reach out to me to try to get me to reach out to Mr. Burt that day.
Okay. All right. Now, at the rally itself, what did you do? Did you have a part of the rally? Did you just sit there? What went on?
So Mr. Burt had asked me before the event, pretty typical, every event that had been held at Burt's Farm before a political fundraiser. There have been two or three fundraisers held at Burt's, at Mr. Burt's property. It's not the farm per se, it's just his property. He would ask me to introduce the people saying the pledge, whoever was singing the Star Spangled Banner, you know, any of those things, if someone said a blessing. So that was pretty customary. And Mr. Burt had asked me to introduce everyone to the farm that day on his behalf, and then essentially turn it over to Ron Hutchins, who was running for insurance commissioner.
Now, did you pay Mr. Burt on behalf of the Republican Party or set up a contract for Mr. Burt to host this?
No.
Well, so what was the agreement?
He was a supporter of Nathan Dills, just as I was. And when we talked about it, the agreement was just to have Nathan there as a guest and let him meet some people that we kind of got the word out to say there's some people that are voters, you know, friends. Most of the people there were friends and family, and gave him an opportunity to meet them.
Okay. Well, let's talk what led up to the encounter. Right. I guess confrontation is better, but what led to the confrontation with Tisdale? What caused all this?
Well, long story. Start from the beginning.
Start from the beginning, Mr. Bearden.
That particular day, when I arrived, I mean, I think there were probably 70, 80 people in attendance, maybe more. It's tough to keep track because everyone was kind of scattered. Most of the candidates and the staff that were there were coming from other events. They had several political events packed into one Saturday. Most of them were going to another event after this, so they came from one place. They were going to Winder or to Habersham County, you know, depending on the candidate. So that particular day when I arrived, I was just kind of chit-chatting with individuals, and I was approached by Pepper Pettit, who I know from Dawson County. He was involved in civic organizations, and there was a request made of me to try to find someone that could address an issue of a what's called a tracker, a video tracker that was there.
Explain to the court what a video tracker is.
In political terms, essentially, it's someone that follows, you know, opposition research, essentially, someone that follows candidates around and just records video, records audio, records everything they can, you know, in case that something is said or could be used, you know, in a campaign to, you know, I guess, for the advantage of the employer of the tracker and against the opposing candidate.
All right, so this brought to your attention, you said that there was an issue with that.
There was. So one of the campaigns had an issue that in that particular day.
This is either hearsay or double hearsay or triple hearsay. And I'm going to object to it, please.
Well, let me, it goes to why Mr. Bearden did what he did. Given the amount of hearsay that Ms. Tisdale testified to. I want to know.
Let's don't get into what somebody else told somebody else, but if he was told something to, and then explains his behavior out loud.
I became aware that there was an individual from the Michelle Nunn Percent campaign that one of the campaigns apparently had an issue with. To my knowledge, it was requested of me to contact the property owner, Mr. Burt. At that time, I brought Mr. Burt found Mr. Burt. We had a discussion. I was part of that discussion, and it was discussed that there was a request made of Mr. Burt to have the tracker not only not video, but to actually leave the property before the event because of some concerns.
All right, did that happen?
That did happen.
All right, well, let's talk about that. Who dealt with this tracker? Was it a man or was it a woman?
It It was a male, it was a male.
You know, I don't necessarily see the relevance, especially given the fact that it has nothing to do with Ms. Tisdale.
What's relevant?
It could be in his head. If she doesn't know anything about this, and there's no testimony in this case that she does, then it's irrelevant.
The relevance is who asked that gentleman to leave, who directed that gentleman to leave, and it goes directly whether or not she had permission like she states she did. And that's what's relevant for the judge.
Well, I don't see how it is. I don't see how
that is. I'm having it up that I'm.
If the Burts believe that this Tisdale was something other than what she claimed to be today, and if they believe that no one was allowed to film but because of what she misrepresented, then they allowed her to film based on that misrepresentation, and then when they learned that she had misrepresented herself and kicked them off.
Well, the Burts can testify what they thought.
They will. Well, I still don't see it.
Okay, moving on. Was there someone who had been asked to work security that day?
Yes.
Who was that?
Mr. Wooten was there, Tony Wooten.
All right. Now, where was the speaking event taking place specifically in the farm?
Under a covered pavilion outside of the main, there's a covered barn that's enclosed that they operate retail sales out of when they're open during the business season. Outside of that, there's a just open barn, but it has a roof, has a cover over it, but the sides are open. That's where the event occurred, so seats were set up underneath that barn.
Okay, now at some point, is there a confrontation with Ms. Tisdale over her video recording?
There it is.
All right, let's talk about that specifically.
Again, it went through about three folks, I guess. So there's probably three people involved up to the point of the incident, the confrontation with her and Mr. Wooten. Essentially, it began with Mr. Mac Burgess. Mac was at that time employed with the Georgia Republican Party as a field representative, so he worked for Republican candidates like Nathan Deal, like David Perdue. On my understanding, I think he was employed by the party, though, paid by the Georgia Republican
Party.
Only
object to the speculation. And
yes. If that speculation has no value to that, but it's consistent with what Ms. Tisdale testified.
No. Let me object to the commentary. And I object to the commentary. That's not a question. That's a statement. That's not an evidence.
Strike.
Strike.
Mr. Burgess was there, Mac Burgess. The event starts. Ralph Hudgens makes a comment that was an inappropriate comment, essentially. I guess he realized he made a foolish comment at that point in time.
Speculation.
My opinion is that he realized
it.
Yeah,
it is your opinion, is irrelevant.
There's a comment made, and attention is drawn to Ms. Tisdale's video camera.
All right, let's stop right there. So get this back on track. Okay. Attention. Make sure I understand what you're saying. Attention is brought to Ms. Tisdale's camera by a comment that Mr. Hudgens made.
That's correct.
Well, that's what I'm going to verify. Correct.
Attention. What does that mean? Whose attention? He didn't say his attention or anybody else's. He can't speak for anybody else.
Is that an objection?
Yes, that's an objection.
Yes, to him.
Yes.
Well, I mean, I saw the exchange on the video.
Yeah.
I mean, that speaks for itself.
Yes.
I understand.
Let's get into something that we haven't already covered.
All right. So that's what I was trying to do. So at some point, you go over and speak with Ms. Tisdale.
I do. After Mr. Burgess spoke to Ms. Tisdale, I spoke to Mr. Burgess. There was a request that I contact the property owner. I go and speak to Mr. Burt with Mr. Wooten. We speak to Mr. Burt. Mr. Burt provided some instructions that asked her. I don't want to speculate. I don't want to go into what he said essentially, but I in return to that conversation with Mr. Burt, then approached Officer Wooten to say, please, I'll go speak to Ms. Tisdale first to try to defuse the situation. I then had a seat in the second row. So essentially, Ms. Tisdale was in the very first row on the left-hand side of the aisle. I had a seat immediately behind her and leaned over her shoulder. Had a discussion or had made reference to the fact of saying, hey, would you please stop recording?
Why did you ask for that?
There was a discussion with Mr. Bearden. That was a request that was made.
Did you identify who you were to?
Yeah, I don't recall it. I said, I'm Clint Bearden, you know, my name or that, you know, I'm a particular employee or attorney, in fact, anything of that for Mr. Bird, but I don't recall, to be honest. I feel like I may have said that I was Mr. Bird's attorney. I'm not certain. I don't really recall, but I notified that I had spoken.
Let me move to strike the speculation about what may have been said, because he said he didn't really recall.
Sustained.
Okay. Now, did you convey to her what the property owners were requesting?
Yes.
Was there any, unclear about what they wanted to have?
My request that I conveyed to her was that she was being requested to stop video. That she was being requested to turn off her camera and stop video and email.
How many times did you request that she do that?
Three or four.
Did you have a conversation with her?
She did. She said that she had permission from Mrs. Capt. Burt, and that then I indicated that I did not feel she did. And then maybe there's a couple other sections of dialogue between Ms. Tisdale and I, and it ultimately ended Ms. Tisdale saying, hey, please be quiet, you're interfering with my video, and kind of put her hand up, and at that point, I sit back in my chair and crossed my arms, because I was kind of taken aback by what was occurring, I guess.
All right. Now, the prior to the conversation that led you over where you made these requests, was Ms. Burt actually present and part of the conversation that yourself, I think you said, Mr. Burt, Mr. Burgess?
Mr. Burgess wasn't part of the conversation with Mr. Burt and Mrs. Burt. I spoke directly with Mr. Burt and Mrs. Burt. I went and had kneeled in the aisle next to you, Johnny and Kathy Burt, had a conversation with them about video, about the request that had been made for them as the property owners to request that Ms. Tisdale stop videoing. And I did have a conversation directly with both Mr. and Ms. Burt.
Now, after you were unsuccessful in what you set out to do, Mr. Burton, what did you do next?
Just sit back. Literally, I don't recall that Officer Wooten came over. I knew he was speaking with Ms. Tisdale. I was somewhat listening to Mark Butler at that time, the commissioner who was speaking. And then literally, you know, kind of, pardon the language, all hell broke loose, essentially, just in front of me. And that obviously got my attention focused back on that at that point in time.
How long was Officer Wooten speaking with her?
I mean, not a very long period of time, like in the scheme of, you know, seconds to minute, you know, something in that range. I don't think it wasn't minutes upon minutes. It wasn't 5 to 10 minutes or something of that nature.
Okay. Did he instantaneously grab her when he approached?
Not that I'm aware. I mean, I saw him having dialogue with her, so he certainly didn't walk up and just grab her, no.
Where was he in relation to you?
So I'm seated directly behind Ms. Tisdale in the second row. Officer Wooten approached from the, would be my left-hand side. If I'm seated, if you're the speaker, Ms. Tisdale seated in front of me. Officer Wooten would have approached Ms. Tisdale from the left-hand side, front row. So he's coming from the front side of her.
All right. now, what was Officer Wooten wearing?
Yeah, that day he had, I believe, Dawson County Sheriff's Office, like, polo shirt and pants, like, you know, kind of khaki outdoor pants, like, that are kind of their, I guess they call it active wear. I see the officers wearing that in the summertime and at times, you know, when they're not in their traditional full uniform, but otherwise in a lighter uniform.
Did he have a gun on?
I believe that he did. The best of my, I don't recall definitively.
What about a badge?
Yes, or the shirt has an emblem on it, so I don't know if it's an actual badge. the shirt has like the sheriff's office logo on it. I don't recall if he had a separate badge.
Did you actually witness when you were removing Ms. Tisdale from the air?
I did.
Describe what you saw, Mr. Bearden.
It began at some point, Officer Wooten stood in front of Ms. Tisdale's camera. That kind of began the escalation. I observed, you know, she's videoing with the right hand, observed the left hand kind of flail in the air. That you know, was near Officer Wooten's face at that point in time. He physically, you know, kind of got her, was just holding her by the arms. And told her that she needed to leave, essentially, and then they walk out, not willingly, but she's essentially escorting her out. She's kind of flailing her arm and her legs. She's shouting, of course, as you see in her video, and she still has a video camera in her hand.
You remember which hand she had it in?
If I recall correctly, she had the right hand, best that I recall.
Now, prior to witness, prior to getting witness for you now, did you see whether they made face-to-face contact in the dialogue you described?
He's facing her, so I thought, yes, I thought that they were facing, you know, at the point that he's in front of the camera, I mean, he's clearly facing her, but I wasn't really paying that close of attention to their exchange. As I said, I was really, at the point that I sit back, I began more so to listen to Mark Butler's speech and just kind of gather my thoughts as to what was going on.
Time did you see? Now, the video, there's been videos in play, but did you go out to where they were?
In the barn?
Yeah.
Yeah, I did. As I see this incident occurring, and Ms. Tisdale's being, essentially, kind of forcefully taken out of the event, I noticed that her video camera bag was underneath her chair. So at that point, you know, in my mind, I thought that she's going to be obviously asked to leave the event. She's going to be, you know, asking to leave this event. I didn't really feel a need for her to have to come back out to the main area and get her video camera back. So as they're going out, I grab the video camera back and take it into her so she would have the bag and go on her way, essentially.
Okay, now where did you put the camera back?
Camera back. When I got inside, she's up against the Officer Reed had gotten her kind of temporarily restrained at this counter. There's a countertop where they have cash registers during the time that their business is open. So he had her placed against the counter. She was one hand behind the back type of situation. I recall laying the camera back on the counter. It's a big counter that's as wide as from here to the judge's desk.
Did you wait near where she was being secured or near her counter? Do you remember?
I don't recall having the bag really close to her, though. I mean, it was in that area, but I was probably, from me to you, of actually Ms. Tisdale, maybe a little closer.
So, when you get to the barn, are you able to observe who or where the camera is?
Yeah.
Where is it at?
So, at that point in time, the camera is, Ms. Tisdale's kind of restrained essentially over, or she was upright at some points, at some point she was laid, kind of had bent her head over the counter. And the video camera is still in her hand. And at a point, it's like out of her hand on the countertop, and she was with her right hand essentially moving the camera around, like, so she's angling the camera back.
Now, do you see whether or not she touched any buttons or operated the camera?
I saw Ms. Tisdale's hand. It was touching buttons on the camera at that time. She's turning the camera. It's on the countertop. It's being rotated around. She's pushing buttons on the camera top. I assume she was turning the camera on.
Would be objective.
Yeah.
Assumption. Assumption. And
She's touching buttons on the camera.
That's my question. Now, were you out there the entire time she was in this, this countertop area?
Not the entire time. I was there initially. At a point, Ms. Umberger came in, of course, it's in the video. Ms. Umberger left immediately after Linda voiced her objection. And at that point in time, some point soon thereafter, Mr. Burt, Mr. Burt's daughter, son-in-law were all around the barn at that time, Jeff and Casey. So they came in, at some point when they came in, I went back out just to go kind of see what was happening at the event, see if the speakers were going, what's happening. I went out there for a few minutes. I came back in, kind of in and out briefly for a few more times before I just went back out, grabbed a seat at the back of the audience and had a seat and listen to the rest of the people speak.
Do you remember who was in the barn with Ms. Tisdale when you left specifically?
If I recall, it was 2 years ago, but at that point in time, Mr. Burt had entered at that point or very soon thereafter. Mr. Burt's son-in-law, Jeff, was in the barn, I believe, and Mr. Burt's daughter, Casey, came to the barn or was in the barn. I don't know. Jeff was in the barn for a lot of the event, apparently. I think he was helping with arrangements, so he was there for part of the time. There's a kind of back room behind another counter that he was in and out of.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bearden.
Yes.
Any other questions?
Good afternoon, Mr. Bearden. How are you?
Good afternoon. I'm good, sir. How about yourself?
I'm doing well. Thank you.
Thank you.
I understand that you are now an attorney.
I am, yes, sir.
And fairly recently, beginning of this year, your honor also.
Just part time. It's a very minor gig.
Okay. But I also understand that you grew up here.
I did, yes, sir.
Your family grew up here.
Yes, sir.
I think you said five generations.
Eight generations.
Eight. I understand. So a long time resident in the community.
Yes, sir.
And a close relationship with Mr. and Mrs. Burt.
Yes, sir.
Indeed, you said that you worked for them during high school.
I did.
And have been involved in political rallies or other type events that they had helped sponsor, correct?
That's correct.
You also, I guess at this time, were a practicing attorney, correct?
I was, yes.
I
still am, fortunately.
Sure. What kind of practice do you have, and did you have at the time?
So at the time, I practiced. We have a wide range of practice. I worked in Blue Ridge with David Ralston, and I took Judge Amanda Mercier's practice, her spot at the law, the practice when Governor
She got elevated to the bench.
That's correct. When Governor Perdue appointed her, David reached out to me, and I took over her practice. Judge Mercier's practice, in a small town, you know, anybody that walks in the door, you talk to them, you see if they have the ability to retain you and an interest in enough case to retain you. The bulk of my practice is civil. A lot of Judge Mercier's practice was family law, so I inherited the bulk of all her family law cases. Ross's practice is with his times and schedule, with his legislative obligations. Criminal practice is a more accommodating practice. You know, you can't really maintain a plaintiff's type of practice if you're not able to go to court frequently. So I took over a lot of the civil cases in the firm, still do some criminal cases, mostly misdemeanor type of criminal matters that I would handle, do assist Mr. Lawson in larger felony type of cases.
And is that what you were doing back in August of 2014?
Essentially? You was, yes, sir.
Okay. Were you affiliated as an attorney in any capacity for the Republican Party?
I was not. So I had been the Dawson County Republican Party chairman for 2 years up until, I guess technically my term ended in 2013 or 2014. I served one term. That was more than enough for me to do and really had a further involvement with the party, really attend meetings or anything like that.
Well, other than helping out to organize perhaps some rallies for the governor, correct?
Just the governor, actually. So that particular election, that's the only campaign that I had any involvement with.
not the Republican Party, generally speaking, correct?
No, I didn't. Linda became the chair after I left, and I would have been available to help, I guess, if they had asked, but essentially, I just kind of stopped going to meetings and really stopped attending political events in general. Kind of retired of politics.
You know, the campaigning that is done in a number of forms, both Democrats, Republicans, Independents, try to get out and meet as much of the public as they can, correct?
That's correct.
Because the public, that's who votes, right?
That's correct.
And you want to get out and meet as many people as you can, correct?
I would agree with that for the most part.
And you want to let as many people know what you stand for and what the party stands for, so that they can make a determination of how they want to vote, correct?
That should be the case, yes.
And who they want to vote for, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So in helping, for example, the Deal campaign, you want to organize events. When you say meet and greet, a meet and greet type of stop, that's to meet the public, correct?
Correct.
To give a nice short, let's get out the vote, here's what we stand for, something to enthuse the voters, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And they can either be in a public place, or they can be in a private place but open to the public.
Correct.
And oftentimes, as you know, these events are promoted prior to the event, correct?
Correct.
Indeed, it ordinarily is the case, correct?
Yes, sir.
And there are a number of methods by which the public gets to know what's happening.
That's correct.
You can go on the internet, correct?
Yes.
You can go on social media, correct?
Yes.
You can go in local newspapers and take out advertisements so that the broadest amount of people you're trying to reach and convince them to come and support your candidates, correct?
That's correct.
And that's what you were doing for this event, right?
I didn't personally, I don't recall what I personally did or didn't do, but essentially to say that we invited people out, yes. And I know that the governor's campaign had a Facebook message group, and I know that Ms. Umberger took out a newspaper ad, so I'm familiar with all those.
All right. You said to the state on direct examination that you got the word out, right?
I did in the context. I didn't say that in the context of my particular experience was that I contacted folks, like I called and emailed some folks to ask them to come that day.
Okay. And you told them it was a public event, right?
Just told them it was a meet and greet with the governor.
Well, you know, the governor had something on handing the witness defendant's exhibit number 3. He had a presence on the internet, correct?
Correct.
And that was a presence that was open to, it was a public event. He was advertising or announcing a public rally, correct? And it included a number of speakers, right?
It does include a number of speakers on this particular screenshot, Jeff.
Okay. And you understood that there were advertisements taken in the newspapers, right?
Yes.
Judge, can I? Do you have the exhibits? Are you holding them? That was in the Lumpkin County paper, correct?
That's it appears to be, yes.
All right.
The Lumpkin Nugget.
And there is nothing in that announcement that would limit the people that could come, correct?
Not as it reads.
All right. Well, is there some hidden super secret, double super secret message in there?
There's not, but I didn't take this ad out.
But it's announcing the event?
It does announce it.
But it also says call Clint Bearden.
It does.
If you want more information.
It does.
It doesn't say call Clint Bearden for a ticket or for permission to come or to be allowed to do any of that, correct?
That's correct.
All right. So presumably, the whole world is invited, right?
I don't necessarily, I mean, to the extent that the whole world's invited, you know, if any business advertises, I assume, I mean,
sure.
Businesses advertise, so they're inviting people in.
Well.
It's an advertisement, I concede that.
Okay, and you would concede that it doesn't limit the people who are invited?
Does not say, you know, admission invitee only or anything of that extent.
Well, how about number, defendant's exhibit number 4? Defendant's exhibit number 4, it does indeed say all inclusive, all are welcome. And you know, you're a lawyer, you're a wordsmith. We live by our words. All are welcome. Does that indicate any limitation on who is welcome?
Does not.
Does it indicate any limitation on whether or not anybody can come and record either in an audio fashion or a video fashion?
Does not.
Okay. Does that one even say, call Clint Burt, your beard, I'm sorry.
That's no, okay. I'll make call worse.
Well, then Burton? Yeah, I guess so. But
that
doesn't even count.
Does not.
Okay. To all intents and purposes, to the world, the governor is saying, come on, we want to solicit your vote. We want you to show up at this location to see the governor, to see the candidates, and see what they have to say, right?
I would say that's like the politician's approach, the candidate's approach, yes.
Of course. Now, I also understand that you got there a little bit early, correct?
I did.
All right. And did you make any announcement to the gathering that the owners or the candidates didn't want anybody filming or recording? Okay. Now, I think you told us a little bit about, and I didn't, sorry, video tracker is the word.
Correct.
All right. Now, did you know Ms. Tisdale?
I did not. I mean, I heard about what happened in the city of Cumming.
Okay.
And very much agreed with her position in that regard. But I didn't know Ms. Tisdale personally.
Okay. Did anyone give you any information about Ms. Tisdale particularly?
Not until after the event.
Okay, before the event.
Before the event, no.
Okay. After the event is one thing. We're
yes.
talking about beforehand.
Yes, sir.
So there was no public announcement. There was no information that you had about Ms. Tisdale. You had no information that she was, for example, a tracker or anything like that, right?
No, sir.
Okay. So that, once again, other than something that you told us about, there was no public pronouncement and no pronouncement to her, to Ms. Tisdale, that she couldn't come in, that she couldn't film, and she couldn't audio, right?
Prior to the event, sir.
Okay, all right. And in fact, I think you told us that you kicked off the event by getting the microphone, sort of calling everybody to attention, and
you've seen the video?
I have.
You have too?
I have.
Okay. And you just sort of started talking?
Yes, everyone was scattered, no one was really in their seat, and the people that were had the run-up show essentially said, we got to get going, so
okay.
We got going.
Well, had you seen Ms. Tisdale before that when you were wandering around?
I'm sure that I saw her, but nothing stands out that I not know who she was. Okay.
Did you know that she had filmed now Senator Perdue coming in to the event?
I did not.
Did anybody say anything to you at all about her?
No, sir.
Right. Now, you were in, again, you weren't in any real official capacity, were you?
No, sir.
You weren't really an attorney representing Burt's farm, were you?
I mean, I represented their interests, but on that particular day, I mean, I'm serving as essentially at their request to introduce the speakers.
Like an MC?
Like an MC, that's what I would call it.
Okay. And you were not an authorized, I don't guess, representative of the Republican Party either, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. And by the way, are you aware of any policy in the Republican Party, of the Dawson County Republican Party, that prohibited filming or audio taping candidates?
I'm not. I know that there's been something attributed to quote that maybe I said there's a policy, but I'm not aware of any policy. Don't believe I would have said there's a policy.
Okay. All right. So, in fact, the candidates, they want to get their message out as broadly as possible, correct?
For the most part, yes.
And do you think that any candidate should be embarrassed by their message?
That was just relevant. I'm sorry.
Well, because
I'm a strange senior to say yes, okay, this should be embarrassed by their message.
Yeah. But you understand that journalists presumptively have a right to be at a political rally, correct?
To the extent if it's in a public location, I agree with that. To the extent if it's in a private location, I don't necessarily agree. I think that you're there, you're invited to be there, but at any time, I think it's appropriate that you can be uninvited to be there.
Sure. But you're allowed in a public, if the public is invited, correct?
Yes. I mean, a journalist is a member of the public, so they have every right to
absolutely
be there.
And they would presumably have every right, because it's a matter of public interest, to record public figures. One of these figures was the governor of the state of Georgia.
Public policy-wise, I agree with you entirely.
All right. So, if a member of the public is invited via these advertisements and via these open invitations, and they come, that's perfectly fine, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, maybe I missed it when I was watching the video, but I didn't see Ms. Tisdale create any obstruction to the speakers, correct?
No, she's seated front center. Maybe, okay. No, she's not jumping up and down and waving her arms. Maybe she's very quiet. She's videoing.
Quiet? Didn't ask any questions, silently video recording the speakers, including yourself, right?
Yes.
And you saw her sitting there.
At the time, I can't recall that I saw her actually, at the event. I think my eyes are like racing around.
I mean, sitting right in front of you. She was five feet away from you, right?
About
this close?
She is this close, and I know that it looks like that. It did not jump out to me at the time, but there's a woman with a video camera in the front row. I didn't really pay attention to it.
So it was innocuous to you. You didn't even, it was so innocuous, you didn't see anything, anybody filming 5 feet in front of you.
If I saw it, wouldn't, if I did see it, wouldn't have wouldn't have raised any flags with me.
Okay, exactly. All right. We then start the political rally, correct?
That's correct.
All right. And I understood that you then went back to sit in the back, correct?
Did not.
Where did you go?
As it begins, say, if you're the speaker, if you are, you know, Ralph Hutchins in this example, if Ms. Tisdale's seated in front of you, I stood to the left-hand side, so it would be to her left, to your right, at the edge of the barn, but there's no walls, so I stood on that side. Several of the other speakers that were getting ready to speak were standing over there. Mr. Burgess was standing there. A couple other just, you know, political staff members were standing there.
Okay. Well, as Mr. Hutchins began to speak, did you move from the left-hand side to the right-hand side?
I did not. I stood on the left-hand side as Mr. Hutchins was speaking.
Okay. Well, maybe I'm mistaken. Do you remember back in May of 2016 that you executed an affidavit?
Yes, sir.
Okay. About your observations during that, and actions during that route?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you remember in that affidavit swearing to, as Mr. Hutchins began to speak, I stood to the right-hand side of the speaker, gathered with other statewide candidates and office holders, and with Mr. Mac Burgess, who was, to the best of my knowledge, employed at that time by the Georgia Republican Party. Remember that?
I do.
Okay. And where was Mr. and Mrs. Burt at that time?
Say, I'm standing to your right-hand side, if you're the speaker, if you're facing, if I'm Ms. Tisdale, I'm videoing you. If you're in Ms. Tisdale's seat, I'm standing to the left-hand side of the barn, to your right-hand side, if you're the speaker. The Burts, the seating was divided into two sections. There was a left and a right-hand side. There was an aisle in the middle. The Burts were seated in the right-hand column of the seating about midway back, maybe, you know, three-fourths of the way back.
And where did where did Governor Deal sit?
Directly across the aisle from Ms. Tisdale in the front row on the right-hand side.
About, like, what, 5 feet? Another 5 feet? Another 10 feet?
Probably like 10 feet or so away.
Well, so Governor Deal was seated on the same front row that Ms. Tisdale was, right?
On the right-hand side, she's on the left-hand side.
Right.
Yes, same front row.
Attorney General Owens was there as well, correct?
He was there. I don't recall where he was seated.
Okay. And you know that Attorney General Owens had seen Ms. Tisdale prior to the speakers.
I know that now. I've read a lot of news articles.
All right. And you know that they had been photographed together.
I've seen the photo. Yes.
Right. And you know that he was aware that she was a citizen journalist and was going to film.
I know that after the fact, yes.
Okay. Right. And she wasn't subtle or surreptitious about her filming, correct?
Well, I mean, she was filming, but I will say to the extent of, you know, how broadly do you define that word, in the sense that the other gentleman that was asked to leave had a video camera tripod set up, you know, so that's clearly obvious. Ms. Tisdale, you know, holds a camera in her hand. Again, I don't really recall necessarily seeing her until Mr. Hutchins pointed it out.
Well, Mr. Hutchins, when he started speaking, he was 5 feet away. Excuse me.
Right.
Thank you. Those exhibits have already been admitted, and they show show Ms. Tisdale filming the last speaker before she was abducted, correct?
That's correct. That's under public.
And you can see the, clearly see how she's holding the video camera, holding it up.
Yes.
It's clearly visible, correct?
Correct.
She is 3 feet from, 5 feet from the speaker, correct?
I agree. That's accurate.
Okay. So it's fairly obvious what she's doing, correct?
Correct.
And you indicated that it was Mr. Hudgens that called attention to Ms. Tisdale. Mr. Hudgens said something about he had heard either another candidate or another person making political comments, and it made him want to puke. Do you recall that?
I recall those choice of words.
And then candidate Hudgens said, "Well, I don't know why you're filming," but in kind of a, you know, "I'm ashamed, but it's still the truth, and I'm sticking by it," kind of way, said, "I don't know why you're filming, but yeah, that's what I said," right?
I agree with your assessment.
Okay. You saw that part, too.
I did, yes.
But, you know, there was another person sitting right behind Ms. Tisdale who was also audio recording and taking pictures. You know that.
Mr. Pritchard, yes. Yeah. Familiar with Mr. Pritchard, and my understanding is that he was audio recording the event. I knew after the event.
Okay.
He was audio recording on an iPhone.
And he was taking pictures as well.
Correct. Mr. Pritchard had some form of either his camera or a camera, either his phone or a camera that took pictures.
Well, I understand that we've got a couple of times that that folks went up to Ms. Tisdale. She was clearly there. The candidates were speaking to her, correct?
Before, I mean, are we talking about before?
No, now while the candidates are speaking.
During the speaking part, yes. So the candidates are speaking and Ms. Tisdale's in the front row, clearly, yes.
Right. So we have had at least one candidate speak, correct?
That's right, Mr. Hudgens.
And nobody at that particular point, either earlier on, at the time of entry, or at any other time, had said anything to Ms. Tisdale about, "Hey, you can't do this. We don't like it. We don't like being filmed."
But Jason, on how on earth did Mr. Beard know what nobody had said when he's not present with Ms. Tisdale the entire time?
Sure. To your understanding, nobody had told Ms. Tisdale that she could film and record, correct?
Prior to Mr. Hudgens indicating his statement about the video camera, I'm not aware of it.
Okay. Right. Now, as far as I understand your testimony, it was Mr. Burgess that you understand first went up to Ms. Tisdale, correct?
That's correct.
You, however, didn't hear that conversation.
Just observed Mr. Burgess went up to Ms. Tisdale.
Okay. That's it. And Mr. Burgess, you, who, to the best of your knowledge at that time, was employed by the Georgia Republican Party as a field district representative, correct?
Correct.
To assist with the election of Republican candidates. He, to your knowledge, had no connection really to the Burt's farm.
Yeah,
correct. He, and again, to your knowledge, there's no Republican Party policy that prohibited the taping, videotaping, or otherwise public rallies, correct?
I can't really say. I don't know either way on that. I have no knowledge.
But you are aware of it, right?
I'm not personally aware of it.
And as the chairman of the Dawson County Republican Party, did Dawson County have any policy with regard to reporters?
I wasn't the chair at the time of this event. and that, and I've been the past chair, but I can say during the time that I was chair, that I was familiar with party rules, there were very few rules of this basic bylaws that govern the organization.
Okay. Now, right after Mr. Hutchins made that remark, is when you had a conversation with Mr. Burgess, correct?
Correct.
He didn't know, you didn't know her identity, correct?
Did not.
He didn't know her identity, correct?
Did not.
And you told Mr. Burgess that you didn't know that, who that person was.
That's correct.
And I guess, as far as you understand, nobody knew why she was still, correct?
In that immediate vicinity of the individuals that were standing there, that's correct.
Okay. It was Mr. Burgess that first wanted to sit down next to Ms. Tisdale, correct?
That's correct.
And again, you weren't privy to that particular conversation.
Was not.
Well, Mr. Burgess went and sat down to the left of Ms. Tisdale in the seat. Is that your recollection?
That's correct, yes, sir.
And there was a short conversation, correct?
To the best of my knowledge, when Mr. Burgess goes to have a seat, I actually walked behind the speaker at that point in time because Mr. Hutchins was standing back. Mr. Hutchins and his wife were leaving the event, and they were kind of voicing, I guess, some displeasure or concern. They were talking to other individuals, so I walked behind the speaker, Mr. Woods, to go see if, you know, Mr. Hutchins is okay, what his complaint is, essentially here from there.
Okay. You then had a conversation with with Mr. Burgess, correct?
When I came back,
yes.
Yes, so Mr. Burgess, yes.
And what I understand happened then is you had a conversation with Mr. Burgess, and then there was some conversation with one of the Burks, correct?
So I go from having a conversation with Mr. Burgess in the front row. Mr. Burgess is seated, as you said, to the left. Ms. Tisdale kind of gives the, throws up the shrug the shoulders, throws up the hands, can't do anything. I sit down, had a conversation with Mr. Burgess. So that conversation, it was requested that I have a conversation with Mr. Burt, who is the property owner, to ask the property owner to make an instruction to not fill the event.
Well, I understood that you informed Mr. Burt that a representative of one of the campaigns,
correct,
that is the Republican Party,
in this case, yes,
was requesting that Ms. Tisdale discontinue her filming of the event.
That's correct.
All right. So it was the Republican Party that was saying, and that was in the form of somebody that wasn't you, correct?
Right.
And it was your understanding that that was related to Mr. Burt or Mrs. Burt?
I apologize, I'm not following that question.
Yeah, maybe it was a pre-board question. You then went to Mr. Burt and said, the Republican Party is requesting that something be done.
I know that I said the Republican Party. I think I said, like, you know, some of the campaigns or representative of the campaign is asking that there not be any filming of the event at that point in time.
Okay. Now, I understood that you then understood that Mr. Burt acquiesced to the party request.
And we had a discussion about it.
if he said, if the party wanted her to, someone could ask Ms. Tisdale to stop filming. If the party wanted her to. Is that right?
That's, I mean, essentially, yes. It's more complex than that, I guess, that there's a conversation with Mr. Burt where it's discussed that, okay, you know, they be in the Republican Party or the campaign, whatever it is, in that sense, would not like for her to record. And then, you know, obviously, Mr. Burt, I don't think had, you know, up to that point in the conversation, I don't think he had any real strong feelings, you know, about that. Before the event, he had been requested to ask someone not to report. That request had been carried out. I approached him to say, you know, they're asking me, I'm kind of feel like I'm trying to be courteous to their request, basically, and essentially to say, they're asking for me to contact you to say, you know, can she film? They'd like for you to say, no, she can't film. Understanding that, I guess the thought was that he's the property owner, it's ultimately his decision.
And you weren't never discussed with Mr. Byrd ejecting Ms. Tisdale, correct?
I do not recall having that discussion with Mr. Byrd during the time that I personally spoke with him.
And you don't recall Mr. Byrd telling anyone to object Ms. Tisdale from the event?
I recall that Mr. Byrd said, that Mr. Burt said, you know, ask her to stop filming, just ask her to turn off the camera so she can stay for the event. Ask her to stop filming. You know, if she stops filming, she can stay, you know, that type of thing. So I don't recall anything further than that.
All right. Did you then go up to speak with Ms. Tisdale?
So Officer Wooten was there with me. We're kind of in the center aisle, like in the section where Mr. Burt is sitting. We're kind of into his seats. After we spoke to Mr. and Mrs. Burt, did speak to Captain Burt during that time about Ms. Tisdale and if she knew her. Then Officer Wooten went back to the side. I spoke to Mr. Purdue and his wife, David Purdue and his wife, just to kind of ascertain if he was aware of who it was filming, if he had any thoughts on the matter. Then I went back over to what would be the left-hand side, if you're seated in the audience, the right-hand side of the speaker. Officer Wooten was standing over there. I told him that I would go and speak to Ms. Tisdale first because my thought at the time was to save her the embarrassment of having a law enforcement officer speak to her in front of a crowd of people.
Well, the first person that talked with her was the representative of the Republican Party, correct?
That's correct.
The second person that talked with her was you.
That's correct.
Okay. And I understand that you went to talk with her, but you don't remember the exact conversation that you had with her.
I mean, I know that I asked her to stop videoing and that I told her I had spoken with that the property owner, that the request was from the property owner to stop videoing.
You didn't say who you were.
I don't recall it. I said I'm Clint.
You didn't say you were an attorney.
I don't know the answer to that. Okay. I guess yes or no.
You were sitting behind her.
I was.
Now, you know that she is holding her camera, correct?
She is, yes.
She's looking forward.
She is.
She doesn't look back to you.
She does not.
Okay. You say, hey, I've spoken to the owner. They don't want you recorded.
Essentially.
Okay. Well, essentially.
Yes, I mean, that's
yeah,
it.
I'm
that's
using right. a generic
term. Yeah, in a generic term. That's the scope of the style of the conversation.
You know, you didn't say, hey, I'm Clint Bearden. I'm authorized by the owners to come up here and ask you to stop filming. I've just talked with them, and please discontinue that because I am telling you to do that, and this is who I am.
I do feel like, you know, that there was some representation that I'm asking on their behalf. I wish
okay,
the audience.
But she didn't even identify yourself.
I did not identify myself.
Okay. So. And she didn't see who you were.
She did not. Yes, sir.
And you don't know her from Adam.
I don't.
Okay. And she doesn't really know you.
She would not.
Okay. And she didn't even look.
She did not. She responded to say, okay. She had asked Mrs. Kathy Burt, and I said, well, I just spoke to Mrs. Burt. Mrs. Burt, you do not have permission to report. We had some other exchange of dialogue. And then, as I said, she essentially, you know, asked, not disrespectfully, but essentially said, please be quiet, I'm recording. You're interfering with my recording.
The idea being, though, she said, look, I've talked to Mrs. Burt. I believe I have permission. I don't know who you are. You haven't identified yourself. I don't know you from anybody. You're behind me. I'm filming, and I'm being quiet, and I ain't bothering anybody. That's her position, right?
Objection to the form. What was that question?
That's what she's telling you, and I have him on cross. Right? That's what she's telling you. She doesn't even move. She doesn't turn around and look at you, does she?
She does not turn around and look at you.
She doesn't know who you are because she didn't identify herself. She doesn't really what authority you have at all. She's not looking at you because she's focused on her task, which is recording.
Correct. She's recording. She does not look at me.
Okay.
I do feel like I made a point to say that the request was on behalf of the birds, and I was speaking to her on behalf of the birds.
Okay. But she doesn't know who you
are. She doesn't know who I am, no.
Okay. Now, she said, no, I'm recording, I've got permission. So you left again.
So no, didn't leave, just sit back in my chair and
okay.
Literally crossed my arms and kind of thought, that didn't go quite like I thought it would.
All right. Did you just remain there?
I did.
Did then Deputy Wooten come over?
Yes, he came over.
Did you signal him? Did you say, hey, man, come on over, I need some help here?
I did not, sir.
Okay. he didn't hear that conversation.
It's my conversation with Ms. Tisdale.
Yep.
He didn't hear that conversation, but he was part of the conversation with Mr. Burt before I spoke to Ms. Tisdale.
I said he didn't hear that conversation, the conversation that you had with Ms. Tisdale.
No, sir, he wouldn't have heard that.
And you just sat back, sort of crossed your arms. And Ms. Tisdale continued to record, correct?
Yes, I mean, it was very brief.
All right, and then Officer Wooten came over, and he came over fairly soon, right?
Yes.
I mean, what was it? How many
seconds? Yeah.
Okay, because it didn't take very long to get from where he was and you sitting back to get him over there. Now, where did he sit?
He was standing to the left-hand side, so he's standing on the side of the event, and he didn't have a seat. He came in and stood next to Ms. Tisdale.
Stood behind her?
No. He was
stood
beside her.
Front.
I'm behind her, so he's coming from the front side, so I think he's in front of her. He's either beside her or in front of her, either or, in some range of motion.
Well, you saw the video, right?
Yes.
Okay. You never saw Officer Wooten in front. You saw a hand come across the camera, but you didn't see him in front.
Not directly in front of the camera, no, sir.
Okay. He was to the side, correct?
I would call it like side, three-quarters, somewhere in that range.
Okay. And Ms. Tisdale, again, was still focused on the speakers.
I don't know what her focus was at that
time. She didn't turn around, right?
She wouldn't have necessarily had to turn around since he's to the side.
She didn't turn around.
She did not turn around, okay. I'm aware.
And, you know, you were sitting there for how long when Mr. Wooten put his hand in front of the camera?
It seems like, it doesn't seem like, it wasn't that long. I mean, obviously, it's
10 seconds.
Longer than that, probably. I mean, from the time that I sit back, I began, as I said, to kind of listen to, kind of pay attention to what Mark Butler was saying.
Right.
And I see this occurring, but, you know, we're not talking that they didn't have a dialogue for minutes or anything. I mean, it was the range of up to a minute or so, maybe in time. I don't recall exactly.
Did you ever hear Deputy Wooten identify himself?
I don't recall.
He wasn't wearing, was he, a deputy sheriff's outfit, correct? The Browns, with the Sam Brown belt or anything like that.
He's wearing what, I mean, and I'm probably accustomed to it because I see the officers around Dawson County, but he's wearing essentially kind of summer attire for them.
But not a formal deputy sheriff's uniform, correct?
It's got, I mean, it's logo, best of my knowledge.
But how would you know who they sell those shirts to? You know, how you get one of those ability or?
Probably some internet company somewhere.
All right. I guess my question, let's go back to my question.
Yeah, he's not wearing a uniform.
Right. Did you hear him identify himself to Ms. Tisdale?
I wasn't really, again, I wasn't really paying close attention. I don't recall.
So the answer is no, right?
I did not personally hear it, no.
Okay, thank you. That's what I'm asking you.
Yes,
I ain't asking any other person. I'm asking you, okay? And then at that particular point, Ms. Tisdale was lifted from her chair. She didn't get up voluntarily, right?
It all happened very quickly. What I recall, essentially he's in front of the camera or blocks the camera, her hand kind of, you know, matter of fact, he kind of swats like up in the air, and then the physical, you know, the ejectment begins at that point.
The ejectment begins. That means he grabs her, correct?
I don't recall if she stood or if he grabbed her.
Right. Do you think she stood?
I don't remember. I mean, I know that as they're both standing, I know that he has her arms, but I don't recall if she stood up or not.
So you don't hear, and how far away?
I'm literally right behind him.
Okay. You're 2 feet.
That's right.
All right. So you didn't hear any identification. The next thing you know is Ms. Tisdale is being lifted out of her seat. You didn't see her voluntarily get up, correct?
I didn't see it.
You saw his hands on her, didn't you?
After they're standing.
Yes.
After they're standing.
How did you get? How did you get up? You're right there.
I guess I was too intently focused on Mark Butler at that point in time.
Okay. You saw him, that's Officer Wooten, escort her from the barn, the speech area.
That's right.
And he had his hands on her and was physically removing her, correct?
That's correct.
And, you know, flailing around when somebody grabs you, lifts you up from the seat, she's flailing.
She is. Yeah.
All right. And she is saying all the time, you heard it loudly, identify yourself, right? You understand because you don't remember hearing anything 2 feet away from you, that when people are involved in a particular activity, it's hard to remember details, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So if Ms. Tisdale is physically lifted and she's being ejected, you know, it's hard to determine who's doing that. You never heard him say anything about who he was, correct?
I did not.
All right. And one tends not to notice their dress when somebody is physically being escorted and taken away against their will, right?
I can't speak to that.
Well, you can speak to the fact that you can be 3 feet away from somebody and not know what's going on. Okay.
That's correct. I wasn't really paying attention to their conversation.
And, but you did hear her, hear her saying, please identify yourself.
I mean, I heard her screaming and yelling, yes.
Okay. You also heard her saying that she had permission from Mrs. Burt when she got back into the other shed, right?
I've seen that, yes. I don't recall, I heard it that day, but I've seen that film. It's there.
She gets taken out of the place where the speakers are speaking to an entirely different building, correct?
Correct.
And in that building, as I understand it, she is pressed up against a counter, correct?
I mean, I wouldn't say she's pressed up against, but she's placed against the counter with her arm.
Well, how does she get there if she's not pressed?
That Officer Wooten has her restrained.
Okay, he has her restrained, and he has her restrained. And which arm is behind her back?
The left arm is behind her back.
The left arm is behind her back?
Yes, her left arm.
Okay, her left arm. Did you see Deputy Wooten have his right arm on her right arm at any time?
I don't recall where Deputy Wooten's arm was.
How do you think she got bent over the counter?
At one point, she felt, I know at the time that I was in the barn, and yes, very kind of quick, all this is happening, and it's a little bit of, Caleb, it's a little bit of like a state of shock, because you're kind of wondering what's going on here, and this is unexpected that this is happening the way that it's happening. She was upright at some point that I saw her in the barn. She was over the counter, like laying kind of face first at one point. Her arm is on the counter at a point where her video came from.
Okay. Well, you've seen the video.
Yes,
sir. You were there. You see yourself on the video.
Yes,
right?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Right? And you're just sort of standing there. Ms. Tisdale continues to say, identify yourself. Do you ever hear at that particular point Deputy Wooten say, listen, I am a deputy sheriff. Here's who I am. Here's what I'm doing. Did you ever hear him say that?
Not at the time. I didn't hear that.
You ever hear him say his name?
I don't recall.
You ever hear him say his rank?
No, sir. I don't recall.
Okay. You were there, were you, when Ms. Umberger came in?
I was, yes, sir.
And she, you could see her on the video.
Yes.
And she said to the room at large, this ain't right, you know, you shouldn't be doing it, right?
Yes, Linda, she was upset, and she said, you know, what she said that was on the video, and then she left the barn, okay. Back to her barn.
All right. And how long did you stay there?
After that, you know, it's in the video. I you can see a point where I kind of leave the barn. I'm there for some short period of time. At some point, Mr. Burt came into the barn, and or Mr. Burt's son-in-law's in the barn.
You there when they came into the barn?
I was when they came into the barn. And after other people were in the barn, I left and went out of the barn. I did come back into the barn at various points, but I probably went back to the speaking area.
All right, one moment, please, Judge. Was taken from the barn area and placed in a cruiser or anything?
No,
like
we're not.
You know, how many events have you, political rallies have you been involved in?
In total, across, from college up?
Yeah.
Quite a few. Say hundreds. I'm not a big political rally fan type of person, but certainly I've been to 40 or 50.
Okay, other than known trackers, has anybody prohibited photographs at an open to the public rally?
I've been at fundraisers, but.
Private fundraisers?
Yeah, fundraisers.
They're generally by invitation, aren't they?
Generally, yes, sir.
Or you gotta give the old 500 balloons and you can come to the old fundraiser and eat a chicken dinner.
More common, that's right. Give $1,000 and it's based on.
Right. But I'm talking about an event that says, come walk, welcome all. Have you ever had the experience that someone was booted out because they were taking pictures?
No, sir.
All right, good. Thank you.
Anything else?
No.
Missed it. Did he get released?
No. Again. I'm sorry.
Huh? All right.
Captain Burt.
Captain.